scathing criticism, I must say, madam.
Wow, okay. Anyway, I'm here to talk about the same thing, actually. And I would like to introduce myself using, can you put my deck on? Mr. Jayavanti had said that, raise your hands if you are from marketing or raise your hand if you're from IT. I raised my hand both times. So I'm kind of like Carlos. You know, Carlos said fat tea. I know I've gained a little bit of weight in the last 1 year. But I have worked in media. I've made films. I've also been a developer. Now, I work for a bank. Now, the problem with a bank is that there's a lot of data. And like Carlos said, I think, where is he? Where is Carlos? He's not here. Anyway, Carlos says, what is your plan? Before you have any Martech strategy, you should have a plan. Okay. So that's what I will start with. Why? What has changed? Like Madam said, banks don't leverage their data. They keep on calling you all the time, you know, and you don't go to a bank anymore. So you have to be digital now as a bank. Raise your hands, how many of you all came with a Uber or Ola this afternoon or this morning? A lot of you, of course. How many of you all paid for Uber or Ola with a credit card, debit card, or net banking? About 20%. So 80% of you all have gone away. Okay, what is that? I mean, the word that we all like to use is disruption, right? So disruption is why? A bank needs to change now. And needs to leverage on data, technology, automation. And that's my core job. So let me just give you examples of what my dream is in the next decade, in the 2020s, for HDFC Bank. It's going to be a tough journey, but here is the why. This was what a bank used to do, right? Still does. I mean, a wallet will never do this. It will keep a small amount of money safe, but not a large amount of your fixed deposits, for example, right? And then it helped. I help you pay if you choose to. Save or invest in a choice of instrument or borrow for me, if you are worthy of the borrowing, because we check, right? But in the last 8 to 10 years, globally, a lot has changed, okay? This is a bank on the top. This is a disruptor. This is the guy you used to pay for your Ola and Uber this morning or this afternoon. And we are all very aware. And we'll solve for this using technology. That's my job, right? Bank offers safety. Physical presence. I know no one went to a branch, but having a branch next to your house actually helps with safety. You know, you can always go and take your money out, right? A branch offers safety. What a bank also has is your footprint. I like to tell this joke. We have so much data. I mean, compared to just about any other industry that is here today, I have way more data, right? I can sometimes tell if you're going to have a baby. I can sometimes tell if you're going to get married. I'll give you a very simple example, right? You stop swiping your card, no, at the bar. Is that a variable that tells me that you're going to get married very soon? You stop drinking now, right? This data is in there somewhere, and we can use algos to figure this out, right? And that's what I'll talk about. Actually, that's the basic thing that we all are trying to work on. This customer fingerprint is what I have as my strength. The disruptor, on the other hand, this small ticket, you can do small payments, is present everywhere, although. The kind of UX, presence, ad spend, the disruptor can do, I cannot match it. Sometimes Amazon or Flipkart spends in 1 day what a bank spends in 1 year on paid advertising. Big billion days, all that stuff, right? Can't beat him. No chance. They have a little bit of a transaction footprint with which they figure out what do I want, what is my lifestyle, stuff like that. But I have way more. So this is my strength. This is the layer that will help me compete in the next decade, which is the topic of this conference, right? So Amitabh Bachchan is the disruptor, fintech. He has huge amounts of capital. VCs everywhere have piled in money, right? He has an army of developers, coders, everyone. What do I have? Any guesses? Mere paas data hai. Yeah? So this is what I will use to fight the wallets, the e-commerce guys. In fact, my MD CEO keeps on saying, your competition, young boy, is not another bank. It's Amazon and it's Google. And that's what has been hammered into my head. So I now think that way. Okay. Let's look at the messaging. Now someone said, madam, sir, loan chahiye. It's a problem. I agree. But that's mostly a DSA. This is what a bank's official communication looks like. It's okay. It's not too bad. Dear Deepak, you have XYZ offer on your credit card. Okay. Name personalization is there. We have the offline data to kind of personalize whatever messaging we are doing to you. But I think this is not good enough. This can become better in the next decade, right? What should it look like? Let's look at an example. If you use the fingerprint, the footprint that the customer has, Dear Deepak, best brunch deals on your credit card in Hoskas. Now, how will one figure this out, right? I mean, I like to go out to eat brunch. This is a particular time that I go to a restaurant. I swipe my card every time. This is a way to derive that, right? Location data is actually available to a bank very easily. Maybe we can figure that out also. And see how the message becomes way more engaging, right? If I had to get here in the next 10 years, or the next 5 years, I'm hopeful. How will I do it? That's the question, okay? What that message largely consisted of was about understanding a spending habit, crunching all that data, and then triggering that message to you. It is analytics, data science, plus campaign orchestration, or campaign automation, right? In the future, I would also want to talk to you about saving money if you spend too much, right? Today, I would rather, a lot of bankers will talk to you about lending, but this can be a better customer experience in the future, right? If you spend too much of your monthly wage. I can also talk to you about investments, save for your future, save for your retirement, yeah? And become much more engaging as a customer service organization. That's the goal. I can't be selling you stuff all the time, right? And this is why the customer insight that I generate from my data is very, very important. This is what will enable me to be nicer to you and more relevant to you and serve you better, right? What will it take to get there? Number one, advanced analytics. I'll talk about this in detail. Number two, omni-channel automation. Getting the message out there automatically without loading a file, thinking too much. Right message at the right time on the right channel. That's what everyone likes, right? I should do that. This is for insurers, bankers, telcos who are highly regulated. Cloud everything. I'll talk about why this is required, because it drives innovation. If you don't use this, you waste time, which is literally money. Now, how do I use advanced analytics? I have so much data on you that I have to get all data together, right? And figure out. So today, one of my core jobs is to put data together. I will take all your transaction data, all your swipes, everything, all credit card, debit card, all payments, all your digital behavior, all your app behavior. So for example, if you go to a calculator on my website, I can assume you're looking for money. If you go to the app then, and then you try to go that, there's the little button there that says liquidate FD. If I marry them together, then I know you really want money, right? If I then take a transaction at the end of a customer's journey and map it back to the behavior he did on the app, on the website, on the transactions before he went to another bank, I can actually use data science to tell what are the key signs of customer churning. So I can serve him better, reach out to him more, right? This is the value of putting data in one place and then running advanced analytics on top of it. Now, we don't churn the data anymore. We just write Python code now, right? That's how the analytics runs these days. It just looks at all random variables that are there in all your data, digital, transaction, third-party data as well. You can now get that stuff in, right? So that helps as well. Now, if you do these two things together, you can tell what the customer wants, what his needs are, and how can you serve him better. But you know, I think Carlos had a good framework. He said, what about the people? A lot of people believe too much in AI. They think it'll just solve all problems in the world. That's not true. Good AI, good algorithms are written by people. It's from brain power that we achieve these insights. In marketing, I've been in marketing for about 12 years. As a developer, maybe 20 years. What I've learned in this new age, you need people to technology, right? And there used to be communications guys, you used to have a lot of high heel ladies doing marcom, walking around the office, right? We now have like big nerdy, big glass data scientists in the marketing team. Because the world has changed. That's how marketing is done now, right? There's a strong team of 20, 30 people. And they drive marketing today. At least in the next decade, they will, for sure. You can count on it. And this is the staff that we need to nurture as a financial services company, right? So that's analytics, which drives the insights for a bank to serve the customer better in the future. Now, once you have the insight, right, it's the right time when you reach the customer is what matters. Why does it matter? This thing. There was a survey within European banks, right? I'm sure the story is the same in this country. In 2015, about 36% of people polled said they were banking with at least 3 banks. In 2017, when the poll was done again, and this is by Gartner, by the way, they said about 58% of people said they were banking with 3 banks. In 2 years, the percentage just shot up, right? So he who reaches the customer first wins. As simple as that, right? Speed and reach will get you to get the customer's attention, and you'll be able to compete with the competition. Sometimes a bank, sometimes a disruptor. So these two things are only achievable through campaign automation. And then automation, again, has to be foolproof. It has to run every day. There are campaigns that I have done, you know, and typically in banks, you'll see it's a set it and forget it campaign. You set it once, it just keeps on running every day, and it runs crores. One trigger will earn you crores. Just set it up and forget about it. It runs for years. Doesn't need to be stopped, doesn't need to be tweaked. Nothing has to be done to it at all. Yeah. This is the problem that most Martech guys have. They don't roll up their sleeves and get into the methods. They largely study the outcomes. The problem with studying just the outcomes is that, you know, sometimes the outcome is because there is a geo that was launched. In banking, this is a very true scenario, okay? The digital revenue just kept on shooting up over the last 5, 8, 10 years. It's automatic. Like the digital marketer was going, oh wow, I'm doing a great job. That's sometimes not true because a lot of people just migrated from the branch to digital, right? So you have to look at your methods, the entire funnel, what is happening, what is not happening, right? A lot of people don't get into tech. A lot of people hate getting into data and numbers and files and plumbing of data. If you don't do that, you are not getting the best value out of your MarTech whatsoever, right? So as a marketing technology person in a bank, I believe it's my job to get into plumbing, data, and sometimes I will actually move files around in SFTPs just to get something going, right? And see what the impact is. If I do some file movement and the revenue goes up, then I go and automate it, right? So all this deep diving is very important for MarTech. Otherwise, you are going to be agency-driven, highly suboptimal marketing organization. That's not what we want to do in the next decade. Cloud. Now this is a big deal actually in banking and insurance and other sectors. A lot of people like to code. So cloud, I mean two things by cloud. One is not on-premise. Second is don't code. Why are we coding anymore, right? Of course, if you are a digital organization, a startup, a completely digital organization, of course, you'll have developers who can code. But if you're a traditional organization, if I'm a bank or an insurer or a telco or offline retailer, why I should not be coding or I should not be depending on on-premise development of anything. Okay, there's a huge movement globally, which I'm a big believer in, low code. Just drag and drop. That's how largely Martech is low code. You just drag and drop and run it. Right? Some amount of coding is required, but that's what we do. The benefits of cloud, which I have realized in the last few years, is this. You get to fail very, very, very fast. Okay? Because time is money. It's lost opportunity. If you're running business with millions of customers, if you can't evolve to serve them better, you're literally losing money. So when I go to my boss, when I go to someone who's two levels higher than my boss and I pitch, I always make a revenue lost argument. I never make a revenue incremental revenue argument. I never make it. Because in this age, you have to adapt very quickly, especially if you're a bank, you have to compete with so many people and disruptors with a lot of money. Revenue loss is the argument I make with those guys. Give me this software, give me this automation, because if you don't give this to me, we are losing money. If you don't do it on the cloud, if you make me code it, if you don't let me buy a platform, what is happening? I'm losing money every time that the funnel dropouts are happening, right? So what I'd like to do is I'd like to get a small piece of technology and try very, very quickly on the cloud. Set it up, forget about it, doesn't work, fail. And this is one thing I actually really believe in, right? Incremental changes are better than evolutionary changes. Incremental innovations, micro innovations, is what drives the needle towards improvement in customer experience. And obviously, of course, revenues will come in. There's never a challenge. If customer is happy, he'll give you money. Banks, especially so. Yeah. With cloud, we are able to do this. Right? Every time I get something set up, I always experiment. I don't go for a big, I want to set up software here, give me the hardware. There's a huge budget. There's the argument around sunk cost. The hardware will depreciate in 3 years, 4 years, whatever. I don't care. I will get a vendor, put it on the cloud, start testing. And when I have a lot, when if you're a large bank, you have a lot of customers, right? You can test quickly. And the data will just tell you whether this innovation is working or not within a matter of weeks. So micro innovations is my way to go. Once I've proven that this works, I'll go to my boss. I'll say, boss, give me this big fat check. I want to buy this thing and set it up once and for all, right? A lot of people are not able to convince their people internally to do IT or cloud or certain innovation their way. If you are a marketing technology professional or want to be one, this battle is worth it, one, and second, it's half of your job. Okay, so I think Carlos had said that, look, people is something you have to manage as a MarTech professional. And largely talk about his own team. This is what you set up under you, right? But what's outside you also matters a lot. Because innovation is not done by just being an independent team working in a silo. Innovation will only happen if you go talk to people around you, convince them, show them the value. This is half of my job. I am always going, presenting everywhere, talking to people, showing them numbers, making PowerPoints after PowerPoint, convincing them this is good for the bank. And especially if a traditional organization, if you want to be the agent of change, this is going to be half of your job. If you don't do this job, no one will listen to you. So yeah, it's worth the fight. Please do fight. To sum it up, right? Now, how will I get to this message in the next 10 years, right? Best brunch, how will I figure it out? I have to crunch the data. This is nothing but analytics. I have to crunch the data of a person. What does he like to do? He likes to eat and go for a boozy brunch every Sunday afternoon, right? This is easily understandable if you're a bank. If I then understand this, then what am I doing? I'm getting more innovation, which is from outside, from the cloud, right? Today, from the cloud, you can actually tell what a person's location is. I know a lot of people have told me, yeah, why didn't you build it inside? Net banking app is there, no, you track the IP and all that. Point of sale machine will tell you where the person is. No, it's very difficult, doesn't work, I've tried it. The cloud can solve that problem for me. So I put analytics and I use the cloud, what is happening? Look at the message. I know exactly what you want, and I know exactly where you want it, right? What is remaining now to completely bother the customer? Campaign automation. 11:30 in the afternoon on a Sunday, the bank knows I like to go for a boozy brunch, right? They trigger me a message saying, this nearby your house, this is a boozy brunch, 50% off. Go enjoy yourself. I'll be like, wow, you saved me money. I'll go straight out. Yeah, so analytics, using the cloud, doing the innovation, and sending it out to the customer right away is what will help me create this message. This is what I want to now attempt in the next decade, in the 2020s. That's largely the goal. Thank you so much for listening. I hope that was informative. Do we need to do questions or should we just eat? No, I think we should eat. Who wants to eat? Madam, up to you. Okay, any questions? Oh yeah, okay. Yes, sir. If you just shout a little louder, I will. You know, that the sentence that everyone talks about, don't be creepy. As a bank, my first goal is don't be creepy. I should help you save money. That's my goal, like with that example, right? I should help you save money on your next restaurant outing. But I should not try and target you in such a manner that becomes creepy for you. Okay, what is the example? You've done some research. Any ideas?
When I'm told, oh, you're headed here, so why don't you do this? So
exactly.
Like, how do they come to know?
Yeah. So a lot of people, you can actually, in a bank, you can do, I can actually tell the ticket bookings where is the person going. I can actually tell if you're going to Europe, you're going to Jamaica, you're going to wherever. People, that data actually is possible to arrive at. So you should never invade someone's privacy and say, okay, you're going to Europe, here is some extra dining options for you. That's something you should not do, right? That's something that is not right, yeah? People also sometimes try and derive with analytics. Humans act in very stupid ways, actually, to be honest, yeah? Because we think with not our rational brain, but sometimes a hind brain. And there's a lot of analytics out there. Everyone has heard of Cambridge Analytica, right? Mm-hmm. You can use the analytics in a bad way. You should never do that. You can never manipulate the customer. At the end of the day, the idea is to serve the customer. And hence, I think that was what my presentation was around. How do you serve the customer better and not make him a tool that you can use to make money off of? That's the goal. So don't be creepy is where I would put my stand.
Big round of applause for Mr. Oram here.
Thank you.